I have to endure people asking me questions. So it's quite nice to turn the tables for once. David, if you will, your career as a wildlife presenter started with the ZooQuest expeditions in the 1950s. You're essentially taking a very new technology to help people understand the natural world. Tell everyone a bit sort of how different the natural world was then to what it is today.
Well, the natural world then, the way we had to film it, of course, was utterly different. But the world then seemed like an unexplored world. I mean, to me, I'd never been to the tropics before. I went to West Africa for the first time, and it was a wonderland. And you just stepped off from the beaten track, and there was, I won't say it was primary jungle, but it was certainly seemed to me, as a newcomer, unexplored and exciting. And everywhere you turned, you saw something new. And that was, of course, in the 50s. It was the days before there were insecticides, and when, in fact, the human population was only a third of the size that it is today. So you really did get the feeling of what it might have been like to be in the Garden of Eden.
And David, your series have been seen by literally billions of people worldwide. How would you explain their global popularity? And also, are you surprised that they're still so popular at a time when social media entertainment is very short-lived and fast-moving, and people's attention spans are quite short?
I'm not in the least surprised, oddly, because I don't believe that the child has yet been born who didn't look at the world around it with those fresh eyes and wonder. A five-year-old will... I remember taking out a five-year-old, six-year-old perhaps, into a meadow in England, and he turned over a stone and he saw a slug. And he said, "Look, a slug! What a treasure!" And of course, he's right. I mean, what are those two things sticking out at the front? What are they for? How does it move? What does it feed on? Astonishment. And that goes on and on and on. Of course, the time comes when other things come into it. And in this day and age, who is not to wonder at the miracles of the electronic age that he sees? But that should be fitted in alongside. If you lose that first wonder, you've lost one of the most greatest sources of delight and pleasure and beauty in the whole of the universe, in the whole of the wide world. And so caring for that brings joy and enlightenment, which is irreplaceable. That is one of the great pleasures of life. And if you lose sight of that, you've lost a great source of joy.
And do you feel, David, that the advances in technology particularly have played a key role in wildlife filmmaking?
Yes, I mean, you asked us what it was like 50, 60 years ago. The amazing thing was 50, 60 years ago, nobody had, well, very few people in Britain, at any rate, in Europe indeed, had actually seen a pangolin or an armadillo. So it didn't matter how badly or amateurishly you were, if you showed a shot of an armadillo, people were looking at television. They didn't look at it in a particular critical way. They just saw an armadillo and thought, "My goodness, what on earth is that?" So making natural history films in those days was comparatively easy, you know, because you just show the animals and people were astounded. They're a bit more sophisticated now. But the facilities we now have are unbelievable. We can go everywhere. We can go to the bottom of the sea, we can go into space. We can use drones, we can use helicopters, we can use macro worlds, we can speed things up, we can slow things down, we can film in the darkness. So the natural world has never been exposed to this degree before. And there are shots in this series of films that we are just launching today, and indeed many natural history films, which 20 years ago, nobody could have even imagined.
And do you think it's the real detail that the new technology can bring out? Do you think that is something that really captures people's imagination, that they can see into areas of life and nature they've never seen before. And you yourself have said many times, you're seeing things for the first time on some of those films.
Yes. Yes, and the wonderful thing from the point of view of a television program maker is that this is international. You don't need language. It goes all around the world. People all around the world get the same joy, the same wonder, the same splendor, the same gasp of excitement just by looking at these things. And as long as the narrator figure doesn't get between you and the animals too often, you're okay.
There's been a few of those instances, David. For many years, though, as a TV presenter at least, you held back a bit from speaking quite publicly about environmental issues. Was there a reason you decided to do that?
Well, when I started 60 years ago, in the mid-50s, and to be truthful, I don't think there was anybody in the mid-50s who thought that there was a danger that we might annihilate part of the natural world. There were animals that were in danger, that's true. And there were animals that we could see, if we didn't do something, they were going to become extinct. And the notion that human beings might exterminate a whole species was a slightly, I wouldn't say alarming one, you just hadn't thought about it. And if it did occur, as it did with the Arabian oryx, for example, it seemed the exception. Now, of course, we are only too well aware that the whole of the natural world is at our disposal, as it were, that we can do things accidentally that exterminate a whole area of the natural world and the species that live within it.
Of course. So is there sort of one particular reason or several reasons why you decided to change your mind about this and have started to make some more bold conservation films?
Yes, and of course, if you were a sensitive naturalist, you would recognize that there were areas, we began to recognize that there were areas in which this animal may have disappeared or that may have disappeared. But the notion that humanity might exterminate a whole community of animals was quite foreign. I don't think many people thought that. And of course, the naturalists were the exception in a way. They were people with their eyes open, their sensitive tentacles prepared to see what was happening around them. But you know, now there are more people living in towns and conurbations than they're living in the wild. So it means that the majority of the human race are out of touch to some degree with the richness of the natural world. And what they see on television is new to them, but at the same time, people who watch the natural world on television get a vision of the world that no human beings ever had 100 years ago. 100 years ago, people didn't know anything about the world. They knew about their immediate circumstances, and of course they need books and so on. But now television can take them to the bottom of the sea, and they can take them high in the sky, and they can take them into the Arctic and the coldest regions and on the top of the Himalayas, everywhere, and you can see the most remote things.
And David, recently you were in Poland. You spoke very powerfully at the UN climate change conference there. Tell everyone here, how urgent is that crisis now?
It's difficult to overstate it. We are now so numerous, so powerful, so all-pervasive, the mechanisms that we have for destruction are so wholesale and so frightening that we can actually just exterminate whole ecosystems without even noticing it. We have now to be really aware of the dangers of what we're doing. And we already know that, of course, the plastic problem in the seas is wreaking appalling damage upon marine life, the extent of which we don't yet fully know.
And why do you think the sort of the world leaders and those in key positions of leadership, why do you think they've taken so long and there've been quite a few faltering steps to act on environmental challenges?
Because the connection between the natural world and the urban world, the society of human society, has always, since the Industrial Revolution, has been remote and widening. And we didn't realize the effects of what we were doing out there. But now we are seeing that almost everything we do has its echoes and has its duplications and implications across the natural world. So that we have now to really to care for what we do, because we can exterminate things without even knowing.
And as you've alluded to in some of your films, David, there are still great sources of medicinal products and all sorts of things out there that we still don't know about. And there are still many species that we don't know about, some that we will never know about because they've maybe disappeared from the planet.
That is so. And it may seem that when we say, oh, well, this or that bird or that mammal is rare and ought to be protected, people say, well, yes, is that just the naturalist saying it's a luxury or a pleasure or... Is it really important? Are you really sure? The problem about extermination of species is that the natural world, of which we are a part, is incredibly complex. And it has connections all over the place. And you damage one, and you can never tell where the damage is going to end up because of all those broken connections. And if you break all of them, then suddenly the whole fabric collapses and you get eco-disaster. I mean, to give a particular example, in the early 19th, 20th century, the sea otter on the Pacific had the most luxurious fur that human beings had ever come across. So, of course, you hunt sea otters. And then suddenly you began to realize that actually sea otters are getting rarer and rarer. And they were on the verge of extinction. At the same time, but a certain group of people saw that the seas around the Pacific Ocean, up on the Pacific Northwest, of the Pacific Ocean, the food fish were getting scarcer. And it didn't seem there was any connection between the two. But actually, sea otters prey upon sea urchins. Sea urchins actually live on the floor of the sea, and they eat small sea algae, fucus. So if they eat all that, the forests disappear. If the forests disappear, the young fish, hatchlings, actually normally live in that forest, and hatchlings from outside in the ocean, the Pacific, they suddenly begin to disappear. Knock out the sea otters, and in fact, the consequence is loss of fertility in the sea oceans of fish upon which we might wish to live. So it's an example of the complexity, and there are many much more complex relationships within the natural world than that one. So that a healthy natural world is absolutely essential for human society.
And like you say, the chain is so delicate, isn't it? And that if you pluck out some of these gaps without realizing what you're doing, the consequences, the repercussions, go for generations.
Yes. Yeah.
And talking of generations, people of my generation now are beginning to step into positions of leadership around the world. The work to save the planet is probably largely going to happen on our watch. What advice do you have for my generation, and what can we build on that you have started?
I think the paradox that there has never been more a time when more people have been out of touch with the natural world than is now. And we have to recognize that every breath of air we take, every mouthful of food that we take, comes from the natural world. And that if we damage the natural world, we damage ourselves. We are one coherent ecosystem. It's not just a question of beauty or interest or wonder. It's the essential ingredient, the essential part of human life is a healthy planet. We are in the danger of wrecking that. if we don't recognize the sort of connections that I've been describing, then the whole of the planet becomes inhazard. And we are destroying the natural world and with it ourselves.
So turning specifically to the people in this room, here in front of us, David, bear in mind they're all leaders in their particular field. What is your message, if you have a particular message, what is your message to them?
Care for the natural world. Not only care for the natural world, but treat it with a degree of respect and reverence. The natural world is, as I've said, the source of all wonder, and our future, we're bound up together. The future of the natural world is in our hands. We have never been more powerful. We can wreck it with ease. We can wreck it without even noticing that we're doing it. And if we wreck the natural world, in the end, we wreck ourselves. In our daily lives, I suppose the thing that I really care for, just in ordinary daily lives, is not to waste the riches of the natural world on which we depend. And it's not just energy, which of course is very important, but it's also dealing with the natural world with a degree of respect. Not to throw away food, not to throw away power, just care for the natural world of which we're an essential part.
Mm-hmm. And Dave, there's obviously a connection between environmentalism, capitalism, and economic success, isn't there?
Between?
Environmentalism, capitalism, and economic success.
Yes.
I think that's quite an interesting sort of topic that the audience here would find very interesting.
That's why this particular event and this particular day, as far as I'm concerned, is one of the most optimistic things I've seen for a very long time. This disaster, this creeping disaster, which has overtaken the world and is in the danger of really damaging it beyond repair, it started in Britain in the Industrial Revolution in the 18th century. And in developing nations, to the natural world at the stage, as it did in America, seemed to be, as it were, there to be conquered. A terrible word, to conquer the natural world. We have to get out there and show our mastery of it and destroy it in the process. And that had underlay the human reaction to the natural world for a very long time, and still is seen by some people that in fact humanity, and industrialized humanity in particular, is in opposition to the natural world. It is not. We are all one world, and that is the important thing that we have to recognize, and which organizations like this and events like this give you the optimism of feeling that fact, that fundamental beautiful fact, is now being recognized. That is why it is so exciting to be at this great important occasion where people attending it have more power perhaps than any other gathering in the world. And the feeling that those responsible for this gathering recognize this fundamental truth, and that people who come here will actually not only recognize it, but do something to make sure that that pact between the natural world and humanity is given its proper place and honor.
You used the word optimism there, David, quite a few times. Do you feel the narrative around climate change and environmentalism sometimes can be quite pessimistic, and that actually there is a real need for injection of optimism?
In a sense, I shrink from saying either an optimist or a pessimist. I mean, what good does it do to say you're pessimistic? That is not the point. The point is that we have this option ahead of us. We have to take the option of protecting the natural world. And we are discovering more ways in which we can do so. I am hearing all around of, yes, we can do this, we can help that, and so on. The fact that we are now actually beginning to get power directly from the sun and the other renewables, and that we can see that there's no longer any need for us to pollute the world with the byproducts of our devices for generating energy, that we can do that, is becoming reality all over Europe, all over the world. And that's where the future lies. When one looks at the consequences of what we've done to the natural world in the processes of raising energy, we no longer need to. So there's a source of great optimism there. We have the power, we have the knowledge actually to live in harmony with nature.
And the world came together in the Paris Agreement to tackle climate change. But specifically in 2020 in Beijing, you and others were seeking a global deal for nature. Lots of people here probably haven't heard about that, David. Do you mind telling us why specifically that is so important?
Well, because Paris was a recognition by nations around the world that we have the natural world and humanity are interdependent. And Paris recognized what the dangers were, and they saw the problems about rising temperatures, about how climate, we have influenced the climate and caused appalling devastation with rising temperatures, and how it was paramount importance that we stop doing it, which we can do, we know how to do it, and a determination of the natures of the nations around the world that we should do it and try and limit it, well, we said it, between two degrees and 1.5 degrees, average around the world. If we can do that, we can prevent loss of coral reefs, we can prevent all sorts of damages, we can reduce the extremes of weather that's overtaking the planet already, and that is essential for the future well-being of the planet. That was recognized by nations around the world, not universally, I have to say, and there have been people who have wished to withdraw from that. But nonetheless, the majority of the nations around the world have accepted that and recognized that and are working towards that. And that's where we must put our faith.
And David, you're specifically narrating a new landmark series called Our Planet. And you've worked with WWF, Silverback Films, and Netflix. Why did you decide to become involved in this particular project?
Because the issue has never been more important. And the issue that it should be recognized in not just one part of the world, not just in Europe, but worldwide. And the World Wildlife Fund gave us facilities to see the work that they've been doing, the researches they've been doing, the knowledge they've got been doing about the way in which ecosystems are working and where there are dangers and where there are wonders, to enable us to produce this series of films. And by putting it on Netflix, it becomes possible overnight. You can reach 150 million people immediately. I mean, I started television in the 1950s. And television in Britain at that time was only seen by a few million people in southern England. Now, with Netflix, it's possible to put on a transmission, and it is seen worldwide by hundreds of millions of people, and will go on being seen, available, when people, word of mouth, did you see that show? It's still there. It's still able for them to see it. So this is a way which the World Wildlife Fund recognized and gave us all the insights and the information, the practical help that we needed to make these programs. And it, so the Worldwide Fund for Nature is worldwide, and this picture of the world will be coming worldwide simultaneously on one particular date and remain there.
And if I made you choose, David, which I'm going to do, would this be one of your most favourite projects or your most enjoyable in terms of actually what they've created, how they've filmed it, what's been shown, and bear in mind the time it's being shown in the world with the issues that are going on?
Yes, I mean, I started when it was just me and the cameraman and a clockwork camera. Yeah. You don't make natural history films like that anymore. The natural history films now of this sort of quality are made by literally hundreds of people. There may be 30, there may be 50 cameramen who'll be working on one particular program. I think something like 300 cameramen have worked on the series as a whole. Because now you've got the facilities to go up in the skies and the bottom of the seas. You can trek over the polar wastes. You can go over the deserts. You can be in the jungles of the world. And all those pictures you can bring back in order to give a unique picture, which human beings haven't seen until this generation.
And I think you've chosen a favorite clip from Our Planet, which we're going to show in a second. Can you just tell us a bit about what we're going to see in the footage?
The footage of the glacier. One of the most immediate dangers that are facing the planet today is, of course, rising temperatures. And where you may see that, of course, is actually more up in the north than it is in the south. But in the Arctic is temperatures rising very, very fast. And how the team who made this series determined, of course, that they would needed pictures of the melting ice that would symbolize this. And they went up to the north. Now, the glaciers up in the north, in the Arctic, are moving very fast indeed. And they went to one particular glacier, knowing that it was advancing into the sea rather fast. But you need... glaciers are always on the move a bit, but you need dramatic event.
They're a bit like children, David, unpredictable.
Yeah, quite so. But they wanted to see the glacier that was calving, that is to say, coming off in lumps. And they decided that the way they would see that best would be from the air and in a helicopter. They eventually, on the very last day of their location, they were up in a helicopter and they spied the glacier suddenly beginning to calve. That there were sections of the glacier the size of a skyscraper, of a great multi-storied building, falling into the water, causing huge surges. Now, you're a helicopter pilot. Is that tricky?
It can be, David, yes.
I mean, huge uprushes of air when the vast blocks fall into the sea. And what that does, and if you're a pilot, I mean, you will know how you're going to get a steady shot to see that. The pilot who was working on that helicopter has my admiration, and you would know much more better than me, how skilled he was to get the sort of shots of the carving of a glacier, which is included in this series.
All helicopter pilots are very skillful, David. But I think everyone will be fascinated to see the clip now. So if we could play the clip, that'd be fantastic.
These massive ice falls from the top of the glacier are just the beginnings of a far greater event. A stretch of the front face of the glacier, over a kilometre long, is starting to break away. From 400 metres beneath the surface, the hidden ice is surging upwards. Of a skyscraper generates a colossal tidal wave. Within 20 minutes, 75 million tons of ice break free.
In incredible footage, I think everyone would agree. David, it just remains me to say a huge thank you on behalf of everyone here for you being here today to talk so openly, and a huge congratulations again for winning the Crystal Award. A round of applause, please, for Sir David Attenborough. Thank you.